Somebody need to do a song for L.A.
Straight up. Just
go out to L.A. Oh, new anthem. Look down. To live and die in L.A. California. What you say about Los Angeles? Still the only place for me that never rains in the sun.
To live and die in L.A. Where every day we try to fatten our pockets. Us niggas hustle for the cash, so it's hard to knock it. Everybody got their own thing coming. See, chasing worldwide through the hard times.
Well, hello, hello, hello. God bless your community family, and welcome to Gang Talk with Sister Herron and Skipp Townsend. You know, we've been doing this every Thursday for the last 7 years, trying to have this very important conversation with our community families, because it's about the murder of our children and the destruction of our village due to those murders. So before we get started, it's always our blessing to welcome our co-host, Skipp Townsend, and thank him for his steadfast work in this arena, because he's a man of many, many places, all around, all about, doing good things, and we're trying to clone you, Skipp.
All right, Sister Herron, I've done a great job of cloning myself, too. I have 7 boys and 5 girls, so
that's
somebody's going to have to come fill these shoes. But I always give honor and praise to God. You know, I'm just truly grateful to be alive, and in the midst of everything that we do, you know, people still being killed. You know, homicides are still prevalent in our communities, even though they're down compared to the 90s and even, you know, 10 years ago. But just to be mindful and be grateful that God has given me a vision, a plan, but he gave me life so I can set these goals and maintain them.
Absolutely. He saved you for a reason, and that's because we needed somebody to come back in their right mind and recognize that it's been a big trick perpetrated against us. It's been very costly,
right.
Very, very costly, and the sad reality is that trick has spread across the country. You know, so we're not only just reaching out to Los Angeles, where we are, have made progress, as you said, from the 90s to today.
Mm-hmm.
It's not perfected, but boy, is it a lot further ahead than it was back then.
Yes, indeed it was, Sister. In 1992 and 1993 was the worst year of homicides, 92 having more than 1,100 homicides, and 1993 having more than 1,200 homicides. And we're talking about in the city of Los Angeles,
not
including the county, not Gardena, Inglewood, Culver City, but just in the city alone. So, you know, it was horrible. And just to think that at some point we had made that dysfunction normal, where we every day were living in that environment and didn't think anything wrong with it. So I'm truly grateful that now we argue and fight and fuss to get it to remain less than 300, but, you know, we're keeping it less than 300 with all the efforts, not just with intervention and prevention, but also with the work of the groups out in the community, but law enforcement as well, and, you know, a number of different reasons why the homicides are down. So,
yes,
just truly grateful.
And you know what, that's something to be grateful for, because as you said, in the early 90s, I used to not only read the homicide report, but I kept up with the statistics from each division in South Bureau with the head count of how many had died that month. And it was a horrible experience to keep monitoring those deaths.
Right.
And it was just devastating. The numbers that we were losing, that not enough people recognize that these young people are leaving our village every day, every week. And at one point I thought, you know, we're losing one every day. One every day, because when it's past 365, it's only 365 days in a year.
Right.
So how many week killing per day? How many actually were dying every day back in those years? And that's really what caught my attention. As I like for people to understand, we didn't just show up yesterday,
right?
You know? And what caught really captured my spirit was the killing of Jimmy Finney, 13 years old in 1988, and cut down gangland style in broad daylight, and the perpetrators of her death surrounded that car and not only killed her, but killed the 18-year-old driver in what subsequently became a question of mistaken identity. They were looking for a particular young woman and found these two girls driving together and targeted them. Right. And it was a devastating execution that the little 13-year-old that had nothing to do with anything got caught in that. And the shooters didn't care about taking her life. Their whole thing was, well, she was in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Right.
You see, and so they were very callous about that. And
sister, let me ask you real quick. Do you think that there's a thing called redemption, atonement? That happened in 1988, wasn't
it? Yeah, that was 88.
Okay, so let me ask you, sister, it being so many years ago, I guess that's 26, 27 years, do you think that the people who committed this horrendous crime should ever be set free?
Now, you know, that's the wrong question to ask me. You know, because I support Prop 47 and the early release for smaller crimes, personal drug use, things like that, petty theft. I support 47. But murderers, and that was such a malicious killing. Right. I mean, that's
right.
And plus, I know her mother.
Right.
I could never tell Jamie's mother that I have forgiveness for her child's killer.
Right.
I just, you know, Skip, that.
The
it's
reason
best
I
to ask
that.
God that question.
Right,
not
no,
me.
And I do. I trust me, I sit here and ask God, am I doing the right thing? And the reason I asked you that is because something you said to me off air about really being impressed with the company that Big John had with him last night.
Well, we're going to get to that because I do want to talk about that. Cause
I don't want to talk about that right now. I want to ask you this question, though.
Okay.
Because some of them have done something so horrendous and so horrible. And one of them, I don't know if he's there, if he was there last night, but one of them is responsible for the wrong address murder that occurred in 1984 where the whole family was killed. Well, he was released about 3 weeks ago and he hangs at Second Call now becoming a carpenter electrician. He's in that. So I wasn't there last night. I don't know if he was there, but I know that people get goosebumps and hair on their neck when they think about how that family was killed. So you were smiling at first. You were smiling. So do you. So
imagine how I felt when you met the man that tried to take your life in that parking lot that day. It's like, wow, you know, this is surreal. That, hey, Skip, how you doing? And you look around, it's like, I don't quite know you, but I know you. And then it dawns on you, and you tell me, he tried to kill me. It's like. And then I look at him a second time, and I see that he has heel bullet wounds over him. Like, it was a hot mess out here in the street. It's a miracle you're walking.
Right.
So
that's why I'm asking the question, because you were smiling. You were smiling at some of these people that John had with him. But if I told you what they did,
it would change my opinion.
But no, I don't want it to, because you know what they're doing now.
Yes, but it would change my opinion. And to be quite honest, I'm a victim person first. I started out marching and crying with the mothers whose children had been killed. And that's the worst arena that I've ever been involved in, is to see the pain. And that pain is ongoing.
That pain does not get a 20-year sentence,
no.
A 15-year sentence. That pain gets a life sentence that never goes away. I definitely get it.
Yeah.
That's why I asked the question, because, you know, individuals do 24, 25, 27 years, and they come home. But it's a life sentence, not only for the parents, but for the younger brothers, for the children of the murder victims.
Absolutely. And so this is one of the reasons why I don't ask those kind of questions.
Right.
When the men come and present themselves and they're looking for redemption, mm-hmm. I don't ask them what crime they committed, because I know in my head, if I knew that one of them was responsible for killing that 13-year-old girl.
No, none of them, no.
I'm just saying, generically, if somebody came and told me, yeah, I was responsible, you'd have to be really humble, for me to move past that.
Right.
See, because that was a cruel act. It was cruel, and it was unkind, and it was so malicious the way it was done. And it was part of the years of murder and things like that were going on. And I just kind of have to stand with the mothers about that.
Yes, indeed.
You know, because we have some mothers that have forgiven, but not all of them.
Right.
And some of them just tell you, I'm not ever going to forgive him.
Right.
Then I've had one mother tell me, well, it's okay if they kill Tookie, but I don't want them to kill the murderer of my child because I don't want that murdered blood on my hands. It's like, well, wait a minute. That's a double standard. It's okay if they execute Tookie, but you don't want them to execute the murder of your child because you don't want that murderer's blood on your hands. It's okay that you got Tookie's blood on you. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's an odd place. Mm-hmm. And I don't, whatever a victimized family, however they handle that, I leave that to them and God. I just can't right. pass judgment on it. And I would know for a fact if I knew somebody that had been responsible for Jimmy's killing, I probably would hold that against them.
Right.
Yeah, because I'm human, and I know her mother, and I know so many of these mothers, like Vicky, you know, Bridget's sister, two sons killed.
Right.
Kathy Wooten was at the meeting last night.
Two
of her sons were killed. So that's a bigger a forgiveness than I'm capable of. I just have to be honest about that. So I don't ask those questions of the men that are coming back looking for recovery.
Or the women.
Or the women.
I brought some women in here that...
Well, we know we got some hardcore girls, but look, I'm talking about the war years when the men were actively killing each other. Well, we started out talking about how many murders actually happened in those years and that kind of thing. But before we get started, and two, this plays into a part, the residue of last week's show, which was extremely difficult because we were expecting our guest to be... someone that had been at a vigil and got shot in the crossfire, survived, but still devastating injuries that put them in the hospital. They really wanted to come to the show, and we had it set up to be sensitive for that conversation, and they weren't able to get here because they had to go back in the hospital.
Right.
So we had invited guests, Twin and Lamont, and Cornell, Coach Cornell called in to try to give sensitivity to the issue of the victim. I'm here mourning my friend, and somebody drives through and shoots quite a few of us, and I get shot too. Well, what am I supposed to do with that? Where am I supposed to go from there?
Especially the randomness of the shooting where... You know, because everyone is here, I'll just shoot anyone who, you know, that part is the animalistic behavior or the thought that, you know, that we just can't put up with in our communities.
Yeah.
And these are somebody's children. Somebody's children was shot, but also someone's child, someone has a child that shot them, you know, and it has to be addressed, and it can only be addressed, I believe, by us and knowing who our children are. Do I know if my child is a shooter or if my child puts his or herself in line to be shot? You know, when you talk about going to candlelight vigils, the one thing that I appreciate with ceasefire and the work that we do is we communicate with law enforcement, and everybody don't like law enforcement, but hey, listen, we're going to need the detectives there to tell the family what's going on with this case and a couple of units across the street just to, you know, maintain, make sure nothing gets out of hand. And that prevents the young people from being hurt.
Right. Well, truthfully, we were supposed to talk about law enforcement tonight. That was the agenda. And the reason being, excuse me, is because they're very much in the news right now. A lot of people are upset with law enforcement. And as Skip just indicated, we have to work both sides of this table. Because when somebody's shot, who do we expect to show up? The police. We do. Who do we want to catch the killers?
The police.
And we really want the police to catch that murderer before the community does. We don't want the retaliation anymore because every time you do that, life is forfeit.
Right.
You know, you pull that trigger on somebody else, you have to look at those fingers pointing back your way. Mm-hmm. Even that trigger finger is pointing back at you. The only thing out of it is a thumb. And where's a thumb? It's pointing straight up. But we don't notice that because we're in the act of committing violence. Don't see those three fingers pointing back right at us and that trigger finger too. And miss that thumb looking up, telling you right there, God's watching you, fool. He's watching you. And we have our young men caught up, tied up in this revenge that even they want out of. You know, the young people that came a few weeks ago, Destiny and Blocker.
Right.
They represent the generation, the 30-something-year-olds that I'm hearing a lot more from that are really looking for a different way. They don't want to be part of the violence anymore. But as we indicated, they're caught up in the circumstances that's beyond their control.
Right. I totally agree. And one of the things that Blocker spoke about was pain.
Yes.
He spoke about not wanting to sit at a table with other people, not because of ignorance, not because of his violent will, but because of pain. He said, I haven't healed.
Mm-hmm.
And that, I believe, is what a lot of times law enforcement and community members fail to hear.
Right.
The cry of the young people, not talking about we stupid, we grouped up together. No, but we have pain.
We have pain.
Recognize and acknowledge that I have pain.
Yes.
So thank you, Blocker, for that. I truly appreciate it.
And you know what? And I want to thank all the other young men that have been coming to Cease Fire and saying that to us. You know, they're in the 30, 35 and under mm-hmm. age group. And they're looking for a dialogue. How do we mediate? And the sad thing is that they're from so many different neighborhoods. How do we mediate? You see, so we're going to keep moving in that direction because they're the ones, the biggest targets at this moment, and they're the biggest perpetrators. We don't have a whole lot of 50-year-olds running around trying to shoot 30-year-olds. So we don't have a lot of 40-year-olds. 40-year-olds may be leading, but they're not trying to go out and just shoot up the place. And regrettably, too many incidents lately have been begun by a simple robbery that went wrong.
Right.
See, that's responsible for the latest upset in the Watts community was that robbery in Hawthorne at the barbershop. And we were really having a modicum of peace at that time until that incident happened and then everything just kind of exploded. So,
sister, what is that word again you just said?
Modicum.
Yeah, what is a modicum, you know? I went to Dorsey not far from here. I never heard that. You know, not blaming the administration over there, but I just never heard it.
No, look, let me explain it to everybody so nobody would get mad. My mother was an English teacher.
Oh, okay.
Proud English teacher at Jordan High School.
All right.
So I'm a Bulldog brat.
All right.
Born
Bulldog.
And raised Bulldog brat, hard in Watts. You know, my parents, we came from Watts as a black community. That is our home base in Los Angeles when we migrated from the South. We all settled in Watts because there used to be a housing covenant where black folks couldn't live on the West Side.
Right.
You see, so in the early 50s, educated folks went and broke the back of that law.
Right.
And so that's why we live in Inglewood and we can live in the Valley now. But in those days, Central Avenue was our Sunset Strip.
Yes, indeed.
Okay. And the Dunbar Hotel.
Dunbar.
Uh-huh. All Sammy Davis, Lena Horne, Dorothy Dandridge. All of them stayed at the Dunbar because there was racism. And you couldn't stay in the West Side hotels. You had to stay in the black community. So that's what made Central Avenue our little hub. And my parents actually met each other at the Lincoln Theater. I think I told this story. She was a candy ticket lady, and he was the projectionist to show the movies.
Wow, okay.
So they go way back, and my heritage starts on Central, kind of, and in Watts. And then she loved Jordan. My mother adored Jordan High School. She loved all of her students. You remember Jesse Jesse Hood.
Yes, Jesse Hood. Houston.
Yeah, you know, your mama was my teacher. And he, it's like, come here. And I'd look at him like, what do you want? Yeah, come here. And I'd come over to Jesse and say, do you know her mother used to teach me?
Wow.
You know, so that was very pride, a lot of pride. But my mother was serious about educating us because at that time, Jordan was the only neglected school in Los Angeles. It wasn't Fremont, wasn't Manual, it was Jordan. And Jordan was just, they treated Jordan as badly as they possibly could. And so the staff that was there at the school that time was committed to teaching our kids so that they could be on an equal playing field. So my mother was very serious about English.
Okay.
So I had to learn how to pronounce ASK.
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 Oh, yes, definitely.
I had
a lot
to
of people say that's axe. Yeah. I'm going to ask you that.
Now, you know a little bit of what they used to beat into me. That word does not have an X in it. If I hear you, I'm going to punch you in the head.
Oh, well, see, that means your mother didn't come from the South, because down South, they don't pronounce ASK.
It's, I know.
I'm going to ask you something.
But remember, she was out in racist Los Angeles teaching at Jordan High School.
Right.
The kids that were earmarked to be abandoned in those days.
Yes,
so it was very important to all of the teachers.
I think they had a stronger family unit back
they
then.
They did. Oh, they did.
They had a stronger family
they
unit.
They did. They really did.
Right.
And because they had a committed faculty. They had from the principal all the way down.
Right.
And it was a time when those teachers made you understand that word was not spelled with an X. If you want to work in their arena, you have to learn how, learn that word doesn't end with an
X. So tell me the word that you used. You said a monicum. I thought it was
a modicum. Well, that's just a word that means a small amount. Modicum.
Modicum. All right.
Yeah, every once in a while, one of them old archaic words would come out of my mouth, you know.
Modicum.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed.
It's just, but that's the history my mom gave me. She taught English. She taught history. She was a homeroom teacher. She was a guidance counselor. All of those things. And because she cared about us.
Right.
And I tell people she loved her students more than she loved me. And I'm not ashamed to say that. I'm not ashamed to say that. My mother loved me, but she loved teaching. She loved teaching. And to have a help in helping our kids, that was a gift from God for her.
All right.
That was a gift from God for her. And just us in that time trying to make a difference for ourselves. That's what that generation was. That's who they were. And I like to tell people that, I've said this before, in the Malcolm King years, of which my parents were very active and aware and involved. They wanted their kids to know, especially my brothers, that they were to live their lives on their feet as black men, not on their knees. Now, my dad got the racist kind of treatment.
Right.
Yeah, so he was an angry black man, but his job was to prove, as that generation, that we can.
Right.
We can.
Right.
Yeah, so they believed in education. They believed it was the key to your freedom. Without it, you know, and what I found, they were right about that stupid three-letter word.
Right.
I had a friend that achieved success in the arena that she trained for, and she got in a position to hire. And she had this young girl just out of high school, motivated, wanted to get in the arena and learn it too. And that one little word kept her out of that job.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. And that's what they told my friend. Well, she can't even pronounce ASK. How are we going to have her sit in the front office for us?
Right.
So, and this was in, 1999. It wasn't like it was 1950, 1960.
Right.
It was in 1999 that people were still holding that little word against us.
Right.
You see, and so my friend was really disillusioned, upset, offended by her employers.
Right.
Because the one that they did hire instead of this motivated little black girl That lady stayed, did nothing, only lasted maybe 6 months tops, and then she was gone.
Right.
Where the little black girl was motivated to get in the industry.
Right.
And see, she couldn't get the opportunity to get in the industry. They gave the job to somebody who was just looking for a job. And
well, sister, don't you think that's
gone.
A system? That yeah. there's a system it of is. Keeping certain people out of the loop, certain
yes.
people from positions that could not only empower them, but could also open a door for them to bring in others to be empowered.
Yeah.
It is a system that has been going on since before your mom, my mom.
Yeah.
You know, and the system that you talked about that also had that housing covenant, the
yeah.
Fair Housing Act, 1968. So imagine, I was born in 63.
Okay.
So, you know, people like Kenny Monster, that's with me. He's born in 68. My ex-wife, Marquez, was born in 68. So that means before they were born, we had to stay off Central.
Mm-hmm.
So I know this. I know my address was 1221 East 20th Street.
Okay.
So people say, well, Skip, you born and raised on West 20th Street. No. We moved west after 68.
Yeah, uh-huh.
It was like 71, 72. My grandmother bought her house in 73 in Englewood.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason is, and even still to this day, certain cities like Torrance and Culver City, still there's no housing act, but they do like this when we come through. They like
tense up. Oh,
they
yeah.
tense up like, you know, can we do, they you know, they ask a question, can we do a background check?
Mm-hmm.
Say, no, you're supposed to do a credit check if I want to move in.
Right.
No, we won't do a background check, you know? So.
Well, you know what? And look how that's coming back around now.
Right.
It's coming back around. That kind of racial segregation is coming back around. The Klan is coming back, calling us out and recruiting at the same time. And so we're living in a real fluid kind of situation between our circumstances and everything else.
Right.
You know, and so we have people running for office, President of the United States.
What's his name?
I'm not going to name either
Donald
one of them.
Donald Duck.
Because, oh, my God. Donald Duck. That's good. That's good. Because the things that I've called him in my head, I can't say on the air. But I'm just, you know, I'm flabbergasted. You know, that we had a superior black man like Barack. Okay, he did all the right things the way they think that we're supposed to do it. If you want to compete, then you have to do it the way we do it.
Right.
So this is what this black man does. And he's still not good enough.
Right.
And the sad reality, he's not even good enough for some of us. I don't know what we expected from him. We expected him to open the heavens and shower us and satisfy all of our wants without even looking at the big picture, that this ain't even our country.
Right. So for me, what Barack Obama symbolizes is the fact that there is hope and motivation and empowerment in the black people. When he became president, I know that so many people knew that hope was alive.
Right.
You know, what Jesse talked about a long time ago
right.
was evident in Barack, like, we, yes, we can.
Yeah.
So I think that it's symbolism, regardless of what he did, regardless if he did well or didn't do well, which we all know he did do well because he didn't have us half the debt. Look at the gas prices that was under Bush.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my God.
So there's just so many things. That's just one thing. But I think it's the same thing with the running partner, the lady who's running against Donald Duck. It's symbolism like, okay, we can have our first woman president, but not meaning she will do anything great for women
right.
or anything great for the lower economic community. It is symbolism. So the thought now for women is like, yes, we can. This is our year. This is, you know, so it's I think it's a lot about motivating and that, you know, before there's a big game at every high school, they have that pep rally.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's what this is. This is a pep rally. This is a
pep
rally to say, yes, we can do it. And I don't think that she brings to the table what it takes to have the change or whatever. So I didn't want to go into politics, but just to say it's symbolism, not substance.
Okay, because I agree with you. And all I see this, at first I was enthusiastic because it's first woman. But so much junk has come out in the interim that it's just, I only know one candidate I don't want to be in the White House. And that's the one I'm voting against. It's not that I'm voting for.
Right.
I'm really voting against this time. And I didn't even want to be involved the way they did Barack Obama. It's like, oh, no, I'm done with you. I mean, this man did everything in your arena. He didn't do it in my arena. He did it in their arena. Graduated from an outstanding school. They consider outstanding. Outstanding achievements, things they consider outstanding.
And the highest in the class.
Yes, and the highest in the class.
Right.
But yet, he's still not good enough.
Right.
Still not good enough. Even with that spectacular wife and those beautiful daughters, you know, still something.
None of the, what are those accusations about promiscuous, the, you know, the Monica Lewinsky type stuff.
The none blue
of
dress.
Those, right. None of those things ever came up under Barack.
No.
Nothing ever
no
like
scandal
that.
Scandal on him.
Right.
Are we at break right now? We got a minute.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I need to hear Stevie.
We need to get talking about the police, which is really what we're
okay,
supposed
so we'll
to
come
do
back and we gonna talk about the police when we come back.
Yes, we are. God bless you, community family, and welcome back to Gang Talk. And we really hope you enjoy listening to Stevie telling us to be free. It's time to free ourselves once again. And I'm sorry to say that way, but, you know, we've been through some substantial struggle just trying to survive in this country. And I'm very candid about it because I know our history and I know what we've been through. And so this is what makes gang violence so much more devastating to us as a people. And I actually posed a question this week, Skip. Now that the Klan is coming back and they're recruiting, should our gang members join the Klan?
Oh.
Yeah, you know why? Their objectives are the same.
You know, I don't think so. I think there is a fear.
A fear.
Unresolved fear of the system of white supremacy. Mm. There is a fear of what will happen if they, the oppressors, became oppressed. So there are things that have to be in place to stay in place to make sure they are never the ones to be oppressed. Mm. And they implement that. I think what happens in our community is a lack of self-esteem, a lack of knowledge, and also unresolved pain. We don't know how to deal with things. I don't feel comfortable with myself.
Mm-hmm.
I'm taught every day that I'm alive that there is this white person with blonde hair and blue eyes,
my God.
And I got to call him God. You just said it. Oh, my God. Right.
Well,
oh, my God. So I'm
I was thinking
here
about the Olympic swimmer when you was talking about that privilege. You know, you go down there to the Olympics. You win these medals. Then you go out and have a drunken night.
Right.
Embarrass your country by lying. about Rio and what happened. That's privilege. That's privilege right there. See, if Michelle, we were talking about Barack, if he had any scandals in his background, if Michelle had any scandals like this next wannabe first lady, they would have never got to the White House.
Is that, you know, we talk about dysfunction in Second Call, and is that dysfunction that Donald Duck has children, right?
Yeah.
And their stepmom is appearing on the internet naked.
Yeah.
And we're saying that he should be the president and she should be the first lady.
Well, you know what? Let's take it back. How many times has a man been married? Now, we talk about Bill Clinton in the blue dress, but wife number two, Trump number two, was a product of adultery. Okay? And that came all out in the Inquirer, where she was just, oh, yeah, that's the best sex I've ever had. Really? And you're the chick on the side. He's got Ivanka, who helped him build his empire. But you got a chick on the side that's talking to the Inquirer, telling them all about your little personal life. It leads to the divorce. She's pregnant. You marry her to give your child a name. Stay with her long enough till she cheats on you with her security guard. Yeah. You put a private detective on her, found out she was cheating with her security guard, and that gave him what he needed to divorce her and move on to wife number three. Okay, so Donald's background is filled with adultery. Come on now. Okay, but he gets to run for the White House, and everybody forgives him, including wife number three in those naked pictures.
Right.
I mean,
right.
I find that amazing. What a double standard is that right there?
Right.
Could you see Nancy Reagan in those pictures?
No.
Could you see Jackie Kennedy? How about Mamie Eisenhower?
No, I would never want to see them. Those are horrible thoughts to see those women naked. I wouldn't want to see it. But the whole part of it is it's a system. And you just went back all the way to Eisenhower. You went back further than that. We can go back further than that. And it's a system that's been in place that keeps us in this housing covenant.
Yeah.
That keeps us in the mindset, in the mentality. So when we talk about the Ku Klux Klan and having the same objectives, well, they're in here. I'm in prison in my mind. Mm-hmm. My self-esteem is in my mind, thinking that things haven't happened for me before, so why should it happen now? You know, it's called a wall of rejection. I start saying they're not going to hire me, that this girl's not going to like me, they'll never let me live over here, I'll never be able to drive that car. I start saying stuff like that, and when I start feeling bad about myself and I don't love myself and I think to myself that I ain't nothing, then when I go to another community and I see someone else who's thriving while I'm not, well, then I'm thinking to myself, he ain't nothing either. Mm-hmm. Let me hurt him. Let me stop him in his progress because he ain't nothing just like I ain't nothing.
What you're just describing is bitterness.
Yes.
Bitterness. I'm so bitter because I can't get there. I want to be there, but in my circumstances, I don't see how I can get there.
Right.
So I'm going to sit here, like I said, feel bad about myself and then hate on somebody else.
Right.
Because I feel they're getting a chance I'll never get.
Right.
You see, and so that's a bitterness that too many of our young people carry because they have been locked out.
Right. There's a pastor, Pastor Cagle, he really, he said something. Pastor Cagle been shot like 8-9 times. He used to gangbang his whole life. He's one of them bishop and taco type dudes, right? Okay. So, but he had told me, he said that some people are picked out to be picked on. He said that God will choose and select a person that can take it. So you picked out to be picked on, and there are people, once a person stands out, people are going to throw rocks, throw knives, and attack. And it's just sad that, you know, and it happens when some of our good people are shot. You know, the young boy who was shot a couple of weeks ago, 81st and Dinker, you know, he's doing well now.
Okay.
And also the girl who was at the candlelight vigil, and coach describes the hole in her back. And and I wish he'd stop saying this. He said you could take the Sprite bottle and put it in the hole. And and it hurts me when he says, I mean, I know he wants to tell the truth, but oh my God, don't tell me something like that.
But that's the reality.
It is a reality. And they're doing better now. And that's the the great part of it. But whoever did that was a hurting person. A hurting soul wants to hurt someone else.
Right. Well, this is the thing. We talked about the pain the flock. I talked about these are real scenarios. These are real stories. These are real events that they're trying to tell you. This hurts so bad, I can't even talk about it. It just hurts so bad. You're killing my friends. You're killing my family. What am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to do? See, and so we haven't had an answer to give him. Because what is the answer? And the sad truth is that the pain that he's feeling, the other neighborhood's feeling too.
Right.
Yeah. Somebody died in their community. They're upset about that. You know, when you kill good friends, somebody, not just the family, but somebody in their immediate circle is going to be hurt by that as well. But Skip, we said we were going to talk about the police tonight.
Yeah, let's talk about the police.
Well, you know.
There's only one that I really have a bitterness and anger and dislike. And this dude said that the community that Ezel Ford comes from is a gang-infested community, and that Ezel Ford and his parents are gang members. And so I dislike that one. He's a lieutenant. I dislike him. But the rest of them, I mean, it's a system that's set up, and I don't agree with the system. But
is he the lieutenant with the police protective league?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Well, we can say that because I really – look, when we talk about Black Lives Matter, I want them to put their eyes on that protective league because – the strange thing here, because the police commission president, Matthew Johnson, came to the meeting last night. And the sad thing about those kind of meetings, we really never get at the bottom line that we're looking for.
Right.
We get the public dialogue, keeps everybody calm, nobody's upset. But in a side moment, I got to ask him some very specific questions about the officer that the police commission gave us in Ezel's killing. And I wanted to know why the lead officer, since he was the experienced one, and that he was a gang officer that had prior contact with Ezel, why did he get a pass and the rookie is the one they gave us? Well, Mr. Johnson wanted me to know the rookie wasn't no rookie.
Mm.
He wasn't a rookie. And apparently, he's got some stuff on him.
Wow. See, that's the stuff they know that we don't know.
That we don't know.
So within 30 minutes of an officer-involved shooting, the news media, radio will know everything about that individual. We'll say he's a former gang member. Mm-hmm. He was arrested for this and that. But we don't know anything about that officer years later.
Yeah. And then the other thing, too, that I wanted to ask, and I'm not even sure if these are questions he can answer, but since the police commission found that they were out of policy, and actually the one that ended up killing Ezel was out of policy, and then their job puts him on restricted duty. Okay, now they want to sue the city for being put on restricted duty, which kind of punks the police chief.
Right.
Really? I mean, what kind of power does he have when the police commission says, well, we found them out of policy. The police department says, well, we're going to put you on job restrictions because.
You know what? And what that should do, in my opinion, is let Chief Beck know that you've done this before with the killer of Stephen Eugene Washington.
Yes.
And he sued and got $2.4
million. Yes.
Now you're doing this with the killer of Ezel Ford.
Yes.
So let me just say that at this point, Chief Beck, you have to fire them.
Yes.
You have to let them go.
Yes.
If you're going to be sued anyway, but at least be sued in the realm of being right.
There
and
it
not
is.
In the realm of being, I don't know, let me keep you, I'm not sure. And no, let's not play with them.
Yeah.
If you have hurt someone in our community, if you're not worthy of being in our community, let's tell the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Because on the other end, if someone's not worthy of being in our community, they send them to the process of going to prison.
Mm-hmm.
They send them to the process of getting out of our community.
Mm-hmm.
So it should be the same thing with law enforcement. With officers who are not worthy of being in our community, don't send them to the valley. Don't send them downtown. No, get rid of them. They shouldn't be on the department. Save some of that money, that 70% of the budget.
You know what's so sad?
70% of the budget in the city of L.A. goes to law enforcement.
Yes, it does.
And you're going to keep them.
Yeah, and you're going to keep them.
Let them go.
Let them go. See, because the one thing, our bottom line was, we don't want them patrolling South Bureau. If you can't fire them, just make sure they don't patrol our neighborhood. We don't want them in our neighborhood. See, because Stephen Eugene Washington was autistic.
Right.
They just murdered that child. They murdered him. And I asked Chief Beck, do you really believe he had the capacity to understand what the officers were telling him at that moment? They're in their black and white, all protected, right, worried about this autistic man that's not responding to them. Are you serious? Right. And so it was an embarrassment for them that they sent Earl Passenger out by himself. That's the most amazing police press conference I've ever seen. When they killed Stephen, they sent Earl Passenger out to meet the media alone. There wasn't any command staff with him, nobody on his right, nobody on his left. He was at the podium all by himself apologizing because after the fact they found out that Stephen was autistic. But they stuck Earl Passenger out there to take that heat all by himself. So that was one of the resentments I had, because now you're attacking the least among us.
Right.
The least among us. Then they came back. They killed, I can't remember his name, and I'm going to leave him out of this for the time being. But in the interim, they came back and killed Ezell Ford. And Ezell also had challenges.
Right.
So I'm looking at this like, well, you're attacking the ones that can't even defend themselves at all.
Right.
They're not going to run. They're not going to, you know. And so I had a resentment about that when we had to bring that to South Bureau, because South Bureau was just doing that kind of stuff every chance they got. They saw somebody having a bipolar meltdown, bang, dead.
Right.
You out in the street 4 o'clock in the morning in your underwear because you're having a schizophrenic episode, and bang, you're dead. And so we had to, I had family calling me asking me, well, sister, what can we do about this? And at that time, my regret was to tell them there's really nothing we can do. Nothing we can do. So this is when we ceasefire, pushed on South Bureau Police, had those major meetings after the 52nd Street killing. That was at a vigil for a elder lady that had been on the block and had been the house for the neighborhood,
right,
where the young kids that have safety.
Yes, and they chased them through the house.
Right. That was the next day.
Yeah, right.
They were out having that big vigil.
Right.
South Bureau got a noise complaint. They came over to shut the vigil down, and this 40-year-old man had a gun in his pocket, and he took off running.
Well, the thing is, in these situations, is law enforcement does not have to make contact.
Yeah.
It is not necessary. If someone is running and they force contact with this person who they know have a gun, the same as just happened last week on Century and Figueroa.
Yeah.
The young man jumped out of the car and ran. He had a gun. Can't deny that. But this motorcycle officer forced contact with him. I get it. You know, you're a police officer. But now it ends up to where this young child is dead.
Mm-hmm.
I think it can be that. See, that's the system. We have to change the system so that everybody can go home. I want this police officer to go home, but I want this young child to go home. You guys go get a warrant, come arrest him, take him to jail.
There
he did wrong.
Yeah,
that's how it is. Or, you know what? I know a motorcycle officer who said, I will never chase anyone, Skip.
Right.
He said, I'll just call and say the suspect is running, and I'm going to give the direction he's running.
Mm-hmm.
And let the helicopter and everybody else come catch him. But I'm not going to force contact. And, you know, these things have to be changed in order for not only for law enforcement to be able to live and go home, but for our community members. Man, you're not doing us a favor in our community when you're killing everyone you make contact with.
There it is. And then they want to know why we're so upset with them.
Right.
How come black folks are always hating on the police? Well, you keep killing my family for little provocation. And I don't want to say a man with a gun in his hand is a little provocation, because they're fearful right now. They're fearful. They're nervous. And I want to clarify that motorcycle officer was not from South Bureau. He's from another agency, called in as extra cover because things were, they needed some extra patrol. So he's not familiar with working in our community. And that's all I want to say about that, because the young man lost his life irregardless.
Right.
He was still dead by a police officer that's not accustomed to working in our community. Mm-hmm. So here again, these are officers we don't want patrolling our neighborhoods.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. If they don't have a sense of empathy, if they don't have an attachment, an emotional attachment to our community, then they're here to kick butt. Let's hurt somebody, take names, let's get these arrests going. It's more like an assignment, you know. It's more like the soldiers going to war.
Yeah,
let's
putting a notch on their
right
belt. Yeah, yeah. Right. That's what it has been. That's why we've had to come after law enforcement to get them to cut out that just blanket shooting at the least provocation. And what did we ask them? Yeah, you could do it, but was it necessary?
Does it get better or worse, though, sister? What's happening now? Because Beck is in his last tenure as a chief, so.
Yeah.
What's going to happen? Who comes up next? Do we have someone we could talk to? Do they move Scott out of South Bureau? Does Tangaridis promote and move to the Valley? I mean, what's going to happen next in LAPD? And not even saying LAPD. Let's put them on pause for a minute.
Yeah.
When does a sheriff really come to the table? They're trying to take my friend to jail. You know, I think I'm going to say it for everybody. Leroy Baca is my friend.
He is my friend, too.
He is not the one who did all that foolish stuff. Yeah. Y'all know it was Paul Takanaka. What's his
Tanaka.
Name? Paul Tanaka did all that. That was him. The
yes,
mayor of
was.
Gardena. That's him. He's with yep. that. They got their own organization inside the organization.
That's right.
They filed. They did all that. I was an inmate myself, and I know that it was not Baca, it was him.
Mm-hmm.
So what do we do with the sheriff department who won't even come to the table? And I mean, now I don't know if they gonna trust anybody because they can't trust each other.
Yeah. Well, you know what? We have to invite them. Okay? Then if they turn us down, then we have to go to the street and say, look, we've been asking and they're not responding. And just to be clear about that, they are the law enforcement agency in this city that we have the least communication with as the sheriffs.
Right.
Okay, so when we talk about law enforcement, we're always talking about LAPD because we have no communication with the sheriffs. And we only had communication because Baca was there and he made himself accessible.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And when we had a problem with his division, he received us and then he went to work on that division.
Yeah.
You see, so when you say you like Baca, I like Baca. Lots of people of our community like Baca. And so we agreed that he got a raw deal because of the people that were working under him.
Right.
But at the same time, we got a new sheriff.
Right.
Okay. That sheriff needs to make himself available to our community where his deputies patrol and there's so much distrust.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
I would agree. I would agree wholeheartedly. And the same as I would say what I said for Beck is that when I said that he should have fired certain officers, well, the one thing I can say about Baca is that he too should have got rid of certain deputies.
Yes.
Because, you know, I mean, what happens now is it backfired.
Mm-hmm.
It's sort of like, you know, that verbiage when the stuff hits the fan.
Mm-hmm.
What happens? It comes back this way, right?
Yeah.
And that's what's happening to Baca,
yeah.
Even though it wasn't his stuff.
Right.
But when
right.
it hit the fan, it came back in his direction. So,
I want to say this too. The sheriff's agency goes as far as Sam Dimas to Palmdale. Okay, Malibu, Palmdale.
Goes past San Dimas. It goes to, I think Montclair is the last city.
Okay.
Montclair comes right before Claremont. So
yeah.
Claremont is in San Bernardino. Montclair is in L.A.
Right, right.
So that's about maybe 15, 20 miles.
The point being is the agency is too big.
Right.
It's too big for one sheriff to control from Montclair to Palmdale and know all those agencies in between is too much for one man.
Malibu. Right, where
yeah.
we lost Matrice,
yeah, because, you know, Sheriff Baca came on the show and he right. admitted that he did not agree with the way they handled Matrice
right.
at that restaurant. But we all knew that it was a restaurant itself that insisted that Matrice be arrested.
Right.
You see, they could have given her a ticket
right.
to appear in court. They could have given her a ticket. She would have shown up in court, paid her fine or whatever, been right. able to go home that night. But the restaurant insisted that she be arrested. So they took her into custody, despite them wanting to do that. I don't know what they did with her car, but when you think that that Malibu restaurant was on Pacific Coast Highway and that substation was way up by the 170 freeway,
right.
yeah, miles away from a PCH, right. and then they turned her loose up in those hills to go where with what?
Right.
You see, so he was just, I won't say he was embarrassed, but he was disappointed in his Malibu station for that. He really was. And we were very candid in that conversation, in which one of the things I liked about Baca was that he was candid with you.
Right.
If his officers were wrong, he let you know, well, okay, I hear what you're saying and we'll do something. And he kept his word.
Yes, he was. Uh-huh. A man of his word, definitely
yeah,
that.
He was.
So, sister, I don't know, we got like 2-3 minutes to leave the people with something. Look into one of those blue lights.
Well,
smile at the people and
tell them about the men that came from Second Call to the meeting last night. That was really powerful.
Right. So Big John brought about, I don't know how many men it was.
He, at least 10.
At least 10. Okay. Least 10. So he brought a nice crowd of Second Call, Wolf Pack. And we call ourselves a Wolf Pack because a wolf is only as strong as his pack. One individual can get a job or whatever, but it takes all of us to help each other become better people. So it's not about just getting a job. It's about, can we get in a career and can we
right.
keep it? So we learn how to deal with anger, emotions, low self-esteem, depression in men, work at being a better quality person. And that's who we have as part of Second Call. And mm-hmm. and he, you know, he works down here at Kaiser. Mm. Big John is building a Kaiser in the jungles, and
okay.
a lot of those guys who are working there helped destroy it. The King Hospital, they built King Hospital,
right.
you know, and it was they supposed to have 30% local hire who would be African American, but John had 100% mm. on his crew, you know. So it's helping the individuals in the community get back to being employable and being mm-hmm. employed, and it really works. And we're going to be working on this. We're turning construction on this football stadium. We're going to be working with PCL mm-hmm. on this soccer stadium over here where the sports arena is. And
yeah.
so most of the construction projects, Second Call is going to be putting people out there to work.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, a wolf is only as strong as its pack. And a lion, tiger, and bear, more powerful, right?
Mm.
But they also dance at a circus. They also put on a little dress. So at a wolf pack, man, we don't perform. We don't entertain at a circus. We're serious about what we do.
Yeah, and you know, the beauty about it, these are career jobs. They're not just jobs. They're skilled. They're skilled trade that you can use any other state in this country. That's the beauty about it. You're preparing men for real work.
Right.
A living wage.
No, prevailing. So you know what Kenny did? Kenny became an electrician, and now he's a journeyman. Mm. He makes $42 an hour. So mm-hmm. he took his money and bought a dump truck.
Mm.
He drives it to the ceasefire. I don't know if you guys saw it, the big, giant red truck. So he drives that dump truck, and instead of making $42 an hour, now he makes $120-something dollars an hour driving his very own truck.
Isn't that sweet?
Innocent.
I like that. Right. 100 and how much an hour?
Excuse me, $125 an hour to drive those trucks, you know,
okay.
just to pick up dirt.
Yeah, just
so
to
he
pick
has
up
a skill. He can be an electrician,
mm-hmm.
but he also is an entrepreneur as well. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, those are the type of stepping stones that we need
yeah.
from individuals. He's done a tour. He's been to county jail. He's been to prison, mm-hmm. state, feds. So, you know, individuals to be able to turn their life around and be doing something good and positive is great.
That's excellent. That's outstanding. And that's what we like to hear, Skip. I love those stories, and our community family needs to hear them as much as possible, because it's more than just a job.
Yeah,
it's a recovery and a way back and a way to not only survive, but pay your rent, feed your family, keep a roof over your head, and stay out of prison.
Yes, indeed. Well, thank you, Sister Herron. Keep your head to the sky.
Thank you, Skip.
All right.
Thank you, community family.
All right.